The Paddy Power Half Hour on Off the Ball.
With Paddy Power, as obnoxiously passionate about soccer as Frank Lampard after the final whistle.
Gamble responsibly, CWE.net.
You're very welcome along to a Nations League special here on the Paddy Power Half Hour. We are looking at the start of the Stephen Kenny era in charge of the Republic of Ireland. It opened with a 1-1 draw in Sofia against Bulgaria last night. And we will have live commentary on Off the Ball with Stewie Byrne and with Nathan Murphy this coming Sunday evening from 5 p.m. as Ireland will host Finland at an empty Aviva Stadium in our second game in this Nations League series. Joining me to have a chat about this, we've got Enda Coll and we've also got Emmet O'Keefe from Paddy Power. And I'll come to you first on last night, 1-1 draw. This is a pretty typical start for a Republic of Ireland manager. It's a typical Ireland away result, but I think a lot of people were focusing on the performance. And what did you make of it, Enda?
Yeah, look, a lot of people are saying, you know, Shane Duffy, last-minute header, go 1-0 down, then start playing, and you draw 1-1. And the more things change, the more things stay the same. I thought it was a completely different performance to what we're used to watching Ireland play. They controlled possession. They had good shape going forward, very good shape going back, except for the goal. And ultimately, you're looking at a Stephen Kenny outfit that had two days to prepare for it. Most of the players are on pre-season. A lot of them aren't even on pre-season just yet. So that was, it wasn't a performance that blew people away, but I think that's what we need to understand, is that Stephen Kenny's team isn't going to blow anybody away. We weren't expecting them to turn into Barcelona overnight. We weren't expecting them to come out with this massive, expansive brand of football. What we were expecting was play out from the back, which they did quite well, control possession when they could, blooding young players like Adam Eda coming in and Aaron Connolly coming in as well. So overall, it's a positive result. It would have been disappointing to lose in Bulgaria, especially because of the quality of the Bulgaria side. But ultimately, I think it was positive, but still need a lot of progression going forward, Will.
Yeah, when it comes to an end of 59% possession, which is rare enough for a Republic of Ireland team, particularly away from home, the three forward players, particularly in the first half, O'Dowda, Connolly and Eda, were all pressing up quite high and putting pressure on the Bulgarian defence. And this is all at a time when Stephen Kenny has only really had a few days to work with his players. I think we have to be aware that this was a very short camp before they played this fixture.
Yeah, and I think you can look at stats and analyse them, but on the pitch, I suppose the more important stat for me when you're looking at the passing is not the amount of passing, it's the quality of the passing. And at one stage, Ireland had 63% possession during the game and they had a 95% pass accuracy. So that's where the difference is coming. It's not getting the ball, lumping it up to the forwards. It's clear, concise passing movements. And yes, there really does need to be some improvements in the midfield, particularly probably in the starting lineup, I think. A couple of changes to make in the Finland game to try something out. But we wanted Ireland to play a little bit of football, and that's what we got last night. They just didn't really have that cutting edge. That probably comes from a number of things, from the lack of time played on the pitch, from the lack of training with these actual players. But that'll actually come. It'll click eventually. But I didn't come away from the game last night feeling down or feeling negative about the Stephen Kenny era. I know Twitter's a bit of a weird place at the best of times, but I see a lot of people already writing off the Stephen Kenny era and saying that, you know, the Ireland don't have the players to play this brand, that you can't turn donkeys into racehorses. I think that's completely uncalled for. I mean, these players haven't played in a couple of weeks. A lot of them are in pre-season. And Adam Eda, I thought, was brilliant up front for his first proper appearance. I think that was his third senior start altogether in his actual playing career. So, I mean, for a player to do that and put in the performance he did, and also Connolly as well, was quite promising as well. So there are things to build on. Absolutely, definitely are areas where Ireland can improve. But I thought that was a pretty good performance last night.
Okay, before we dig into some of the individual performances, Emmet, your overall impression of how Ireland played under Stephen Kenny last night?
I tend to agree with Enda. I thought it was a fairly decent performance. I think there was clearly an emphasis on a kind of a more proactive approach. I think just to add that, I think there was definitely an emphasis on both centre halves, both Shane Duffy and John Egan, passing the ball out from the back and even stepping into midfield. So if you compare last night's game to our Euro 2020 qualifying matches against the opposition we would have been expected to beat, which were Georgia and Gibraltar, Shane Duffy averaged 56 passes a game in those four matches. Last night he had 80. and then John Egan at 95. So I think that illustrates some of the changes that Kenny's seeking to introduce. But as Enda alluded to, I think if you're having such a shift in style of play from what's gone before and limited enough training sessions to implement it, it's clearly going to take time. And I think last night was a start. I would hopefully expect gradual improvement, and possibly the team may improve with a couple of new additions in midfield also.
Yeah, Emmet, the big call, I guess, before the game was Seamus Coleman, the captain for the previous campaign, trying to qualify for the European Championships and hadn't been dropped when fit for Ireland in 8 seasons, is left out entirely for Matt Doherty to play on the right-hand side. That was a big call from Stephen Kenny. What did you make of Doherty's performance down the right-hand side?
I thought it was just okay. Doherty was just okay, to be honest. I know it's a big call because of Coleman's history with Ireland, but on Premier League form, I think there's a bit of a gulf between class between the two players. But I still, as I mentioned last week, I do think Ireland's best formation would be to get Coleman in there in a back three. With some of the struggles we have in midfield, I think it's really important to get Stevens and Doherty as high up the pitch as possible and get them on the ball in good crossing positions. Like you saw when Stevens got in behind, had that lovely cut back to Callum O'Dowda, which O'Dowda fluffed his lines, but I think it was still an excellent attack. I think there has to be a huge emphasis on the team in getting Stevens and Doherty in as good a positions as possible. Because to be honest, given our inexperience in attack and lack of creativity in midfield, I think they're nearly our two biggest attacking weapons.
Enda Coll, you wrote off Matt Doherty pretty much immediately after the game. You tweeted to say that Seamus Coleman should be playing if Ireland are going to play a back four. Now, is that the Donegal man in you, or why are you saying that Coleman should be back in?
Well, I actually wrote during the game, which Kevin Coban agreed with, that Matt Doherty is an excellent player by all accounts, has had the better season in the Premier League than Seamus Coleman. But in a back four, he doesn't look the same player. He's not an out-and-out fullback. He's a right wing-back who gets forward, gets in behind the defence, and he looked a bit restrained last night when it came to it. Bulgaria did a quite a good job at stopping him because they played quite a high line and quite a wide middle four as well, and they were able to stop Matt Doherty from pushing on and getting forward. But what I would have liked to see Matt Doherty doing last night was the fact that Callum O'Dowda likes to cut in on his left foot, did it a number of times last night as well, was getting in and on the overlap. And I think Seamus Coleman's actually a master at this, especially at a back four, because he knows he has the ability to do it defensively, that he will be back in position by the time the play is back and he needs to be there. Whereas Matt Doherty, he looked a little bit, I don't know, scared to get forward, because maybe it's because he's not used to being played as a normal fullback. But it's not the fact that Doherty is a better player than Coleman. It's just the fact that if you're playing a back four, you're playing Matt Doherty out of position. So why not try get both of them into the team and get Coleman in almost as a cover at the right side of the centre backs, and let Matt Doherty and Enda Stevens, who also plays as a wing back, get forward naturally the way they do. That's how I see Ireland playing. Obviously, that's what, two managers now that haven't done that. Maybe Stephen Kenny might try it against Finland, but by the looks of it, he's going to go for a 4-3-3. And it's going to be either Coleman or Doherty. But I think that's a shame. I think both of them have a place in this team.
Mm. The thing about it is, Emmet, maybe the balance isn't quite there down that right-hand side if you've got Callum O'Dowda, who likes to cut into positions where he can use his left foot and likes to move infield. Doherty, at club level, usually has a player ahead of him who keeps the width and he can go inside. Even if you look at his heat maps, he's oftentimes around the penalty spot at the end of moves as opposed to being out wide. I noticed last night that Matt Doherty's natural instincts sometimes were to cut inside as opposed to keeping that width out on the right.
I think that's certainly the case. I think it's definitely a fair point to make that kind of Doherty, to some extent, is product of a slightly kind of unique and very effective Wolves system. And I think outside of that, it's being kind of playing outside of that and kind of being forced to almost kind of create for himself on the right-hand side, I don't think you're seeing, you're definitely not seeing him at his most effective. And I think that's something we need to address. Again, just like I think he is possibly our most talented player. I think I would try and get him, if at all possible, in the best position to succeed.
And give me a breakdown of Adam Eda then in his first game, making his debut, 19 years of age, very little football in the second half of the season for Norwich, despite getting that hat-trick against Preston in the FA Cup when it seemed like things were going to kick on for him. Starts at Old Trafford when Timi Pukui was injured, and then he just didn't seem to get a whole lot of football afterwards. What did you make of it from a guy who understandably would be a bit rusty given the lack of football?
I thought it was excellent. His hold-up play was brilliant. His first touch a couple of times when he was able to just get it off first time to the midfielder coming on. I thought he did as much as he possibly could have done in that game, and you can see why Stephen Kenny favours him, because going into the game, Stephen Kenny spoke about how, you know, he's so calm, he's so competitive, and that going into this game, it won't faze him, the fact that he's so young and leading the Ireland line, that he will actually thrive in that. And I thought he did. I suppose one improvement that he could make is probably getting into the box a bit more when it came to the ball being out wide. There was a couple of crosses went across the box and there was nobody actually getting into the six-yard box. I'm not sure that's what Anamita is as a striker. I think he's more of a sort of a McGoldrick figure where you get the ball to him, he holds it up well and then gets it out wide to the other players. And I think he did everything that Stephen Kenny would have asked of him last night. Looked a bit tired come the end of the game, so it was a good choice to get him off the pitch and get Shane Long on to see if he could do anything. So I think he will be a good addition to this Ireland squad, whether he's the one that will lead Ireland to the Euros. Does he have the experience to do that? Probably not. I'd say McGoldrick will still be Ireland's number one striker when he's back fit. But ultimately, he's a very good option to have coming off the bench if he's going to perform like that. And it's great to see young talent finally getting the chances. I saw, like, it was a bit weird with Mick McCarthy on CoComs last night talking about what he did and basically did an analysis of every single Mick McCarthy game in charge. And he spoke about Anamita and about how he didn't really think that he was going to push on to be the number one striker just yet, that he wanted to give them time to develop. But you need to give these players chances in these games, and Stephen Kenny started to do that, and I think Adamito will get a couple of goals in this Nations League.
Do you know what, Enda? We got a bit of an insight into maybe the difference between Mick McCarthy and Stephen Kenny too, because Rob Hawthorn was oftentimes asking Mick McCarthy about the game last year against Bulgaria where Ireland won 3-1 at the Aviva in a friendly, and he kept on bringing up the point that night they troubled Bulgaria by getting crosses, and what McCarthy wanted to do was players to get out into wide positions and whip it into the box. And while Stephen Kenny's strikers were more about ball retention and trying to work angles and being patient, it was almost like getting a director's commentary of the new manager from the previous manager. It was a pretty good idea by Sky to put him on commentary, but it was quite bizarre at the same time.
It was a weird situation. It didn't make sense to me. It was a great choice from Sky. Like, I mean, that's box office getting the last manager to co-commentate on the current manager. But yeah, you get a real insight into the different ideals that Mick McCarthy had. He wanted Shane Duffy to get forward a bit more. Apparently, Conor Hourihan has a wand of a left foot, because Mick McCarthy said that about 15 times.
Yeah.
And then getting crosses into the box. That was his three main talking points for the entire game. So yeah, you see the difference between Mick McCarthy and Stephen Kenny already. I mean, even just the manner in which Ireland were playing out from the back, the way Randolph, instead of getting the ball into his hands under Mick McCarthy and Martin O'Neill in his latter stages, the first thing would be to hoof the ball up to David McGoldrick, see if he can get a flick on it, whereas Randolph was playing it out, was pretty much throwing it out to the fullbacks almost every time he got the ball. So you can see the real shift here, but it is going to take time. It's not going to happen overnight. It's almost boring saying that at this stage, but that's the truth of it, really.
I'll ask you about Adamita, because it would seem to me that Stephen Kenny is sticking with what he has generally liked to play, which is a focal point striker and then two inverted wingers as the wide players in his attack. So as a result, if he's going to stick with that, the two players that would fit that mould would be Adamita and then also Dave McGoldrick when he's fit again. Given that these games are important in and of themselves in terms of the Nations League, but also a kind of a blooding ground ahead of that game in Bratislava against Slovakia, which is on the horizon now in the qualifiers for Euro 2020, I would imagine that Adamita has to impress to try and get ahead of David McGoldrick. I would think that McGoldrick is still probably Ireland's best option in that position.
Yeah, I certainly agree with that. I think Ida definitely showed flashes, and just I was kind of hoping that someone might snap up Timo Pukki this summer so Ida would get more opportunities with Norwich. I'd just be concerned about how much game time he'd get at club level, because he's certainly at an age where he needs to play. And he's clearly a player of promise. But I thought McGoldrick was our best player in the qualifiers. He does. I know his finishing can be suspect at times, but everything else in his game I think is really superb. His link-up play, and he kind of brings, he gets Ireland up the pitch so well. He can turn kind of a long lump of ball into, and he'll chest it down, and he'll bring the wing backs forward. I think even with Sheffield United, his link-up play is really outstanding. And I think him being back in the team will improve Ireland significantly.
Emmet, give me your feeling on the midfield then, because there were a few options going into this. Malumphy could have been brought straight into the team. Wasn't the case. Harry Arthur, many people were speculating during the week, could get a start. In the end, he went with a bit more of an experienced midfield with Hendrick, Harahan, and then James McCarthy at the base. What did you make of the midfield last night? They obviously kept the ball quite a bit, but in terms of being creative, what did you think of that midfield?
It still looks short of a bit of vibrancy and creativity. I think Ireland's midfield has been lacking for a few years now. I think at least under Stephen Kenny, I think he'll certainly experiment. I'm not sure Harry Arthur is the answer. I'm just from watching him in the Championship last season, he doesn't seem to be quite the player he was at Bournemouth a few years ago. I haven't seen that much from him, but from what I've seen of Jason Malumby, I've liked. He'll certainly bring a lot of energy to the midfield, so I'd like to see him get a chance maybe ahead of Harahan, really. I know James McCarthy had a shaky game last night, but I do think at his best, he's a very effective Premier League player in the holding midfield role. I think against better opposition, I think McCarthy will be a player of value for us in future.
What do you think, Enda? I mean, we even heard calls, I think Stephen Elliott was saying, get Glenn Whelan back, put him at the base of that midfield. If they're going to play a three, Enda, you know, they have to try and find a balance between that three. Is there an argument, particularly with this Finland game coming up on Sunday, that Malumby and maybe Arthur could come into the team?
I think so. Jack Byrne was trending on Twitter last night after the game. It's a sign of where the midfield is at the minute. But I think Malumby needs to come in. He has, from what we've seen of him this year, exactly what Ireland need in that midfield. A bit of passion, a bit of creativity when you need it, but a bit of character as well, and just a bit of personality about him. For his age, he is quite a good leader. He's very, very confident in his own ability. He can pass the ball, he can carry the ball, and he can do the dirty work as well. So I think he's perfect to sit at that base. It's just, the question is who sits in front of them and who sits in where James McCarthy was playing, because James McCarthy was poor last night. There's no two ways about it. And he hasn't really been good for Ireland at any stage, really. But of the quality players that we have, he probably is the best option there. I'm not in the bring Glenn Whelan back camp. I mean, he's playing Fleetwood Town still, so like, are we at that stage now where we want to bring in the old guard again? I've nothing against Glenn Whelan. He was excellent last year when he came back in, but is that really what Ireland want to do? Do they want to keep continuing in this phase where we panic once one fixture doesn't go our way and we bring in the old folks and see what they can do, or do we blood young people in like Jason Malumby, bring him into the team? And as for the forward-playing player, I thought Brady would be quite good in that position. Mm. He's not playing enough club football. That's the biggest issue. So he needs to probably get a move away from Burnley if he wants to do that. I do think Arthur is a good option coming from deep as well if we have someone to do the dirty work, because he is good at getting the ball, driving with it, and linking up play. I do agree with Emmet. He's not the player that he used to be about 4 or 5 seasons ago, but he's still a good option to have there. I do think midfield is where we're lacking the most, because the link-up play between the strikers and the midfield just wasn't there last night. That's where most of the play was breaking up. So that's where Ireland need to improve big time. Which players and which formation Stephen Kenny chooses to go for will define that, and will probably define his next few months as well.
One thing that really surprised me, and got to give all credit to Stephen Kenny for having this stat at the front of his mind, which is that Ireland scored from a corner for the first time since 2017 when Daryl Murphy grabbed a goal. And for some reason, Stephen Kenny knew that straight away when he was asked about it last night by Sky Sports. I was a little bit surprised by this, but then I did a quick look back through the goals that Ireland scored in the last two campaigns. Scored quite a few from free kicks where the likes of Keogh and Duffy went up to get on the end of crosses. But we hadn't scored from a corner until then. So Stephen Kenny's set piece specialist.
Yeah, exactly. It's somewhat of a stat. Some of the set pieces we probably had were effectively corners to some extent. I'm interested to see how kind of Shane Duffy can adapt under Kenny. Because I think Ireland's shift in style of play and also his move to Celtic, I think will be a test of whether Duffy can kind of adapt late in his career. One of the reasons Duffy lost his place in the Brighton team last season was because their new manager, Graham Potter, clearly wanted a centre-half who was comfortable on the ball. And so they signed Adam Webster from Bristol City for £20 million. And Duffy didn't play nearly as much. I think with Ireland now under Kenny and at Celtic, he'll be playing in teams that are looking to be more proactive. I do think that will be a test of Duffy.
Enda, what do you think? You're a Celtic well-wisher, so you've got kind of a one eye on this from club level as much as international. Duffy is going to have to adapt a little bit, but I thought it was interesting that Stephen Kenny gave him the armband for last night, which to me seemed like a real kind of a seal of approval that Duffy's going to be the key defender in his back four.
Yeah, like Shane Duffy, yes, he's not great on the ball, but he's our best defender. He has been for the last couple of years. He got the goal last night. He's a threat from set pieces. He's solid for 90% of the games. And yes, you can be critical of his involvement in the Bulgaria goal, but you can also be critical of the midfield for it as well. Mistakes will happen, but ultimately, Shane Duffy is a defender first and a ball player second. He admits that himself. He will have to adapt to Celtic. He will have to adapt for Stephen Kenny. But I mean, it's not rocket science. It's not something that where he's... I think he's going to struggle with too bad. I mean, it's changing from getting the ball and hoofing it up the pitch to getting the ball and giving it to your fullback, or getting the ball and drawing in a midfielder and then passing it into your midfield. So I think we put too much onus on ball-playing players. These players are professional footballers. They know how to pass the ball. They know how to pick out a pass from 5 yards away. That's what you're asking of Shane Duffy. I think he's good enough to do that, to be honest.
OK, Emmet, let's ask you about Aaron Connolly, because I get a feeling that he's going to retain his place for the game against Finland in Dublin on Sunday evening. I thought he was really bright, Connolly, throughout the game. A lot of Ireland's best plays seemed to come down that left-hand side, whether it was Enda Stevens going an overlapping run or Connolly getting in behind their defence with his intelligent running. I thought he was one of the real kind of bright spots about last night.
I would totally agree. I think as well, one of the things you like about him, he's always in the game, whether he's pressing the opposition or he's just like, I know he threw a hand into the face of one of the Bulgarian defenders, but I feel like that style of play is something just that we've been lacking in for many years, and especially if Kenny is looking to play a more high pressing style, I think Connolly's energy would be a huge addition. I think also at club level, Graham Potter would have a huge emphasis on youth development dating back to Swansea and then his work in Sweden. And he's given Connolly a chance at quite a young age. So I'd be hopeful Connolly would get a fair bit of game time at Brighton this season. And I think he could develop into a pretty exciting player for us. I've a lot of hopes for him.
Our football coverage here on Off the Ball is with thanks to Paddy Power. Emmet, how are Paddy Power calling this game on Sunday then? With the way Sky Sports coverage went, it seemed I saw nearly the entire Wales game after the match because they were splitting the coverage very much, I think about 70-30 on that Wales win in Finland, and they weren't too impressed with how Finland played. How are Paddy Power calling it odds-wise for this Sunday?
Yeah, so Ireland are 8-11 favourites, the draw is 11-5, and Finland are outsiders at 7-2.
Okay, Enda, go on, give me what you think is going to happen this weekend, because I'm assuming that Stephen Kenny, particularly with the quick turnaround, they will only have come back from Bulgaria in the early hours of this morning. They'll probably have a session tomorrow and then they're straight back into the game on Sunday. I'm guessing he's probably going to make a few changes here, Enda.
I'd say a couple of changes. He won't make wholesale changes. He said that already before going into these games in the press conference, that although there is a tight turnaround and although the players haven't played that much, that he won't be making wholesale changes. Do think there will be a change in the back four. Coleman probably will come in. I do think Jason Malumbi will come into the team. I think Harry Archer will get a chance as well. Shane Long will probably start up front. But I think that's as far as it'll go. I can see James McCarthy retaining his place. Jeff Hendricks starting as that front line midfielder as well.
Callum Robinson might come in maybe.
Callum Robinson's potential come in for Callum O'Dowda. I thought O'Dowda was quite good last night as well. He got on the ball well, took on a few players. Maybe could have did better with his end product, but ultimately he was brave on the ball, and that's what you want to see with your wide players. So Callum Robinson could come in as well.
Part of Robinson's issue here as well ended the fact that he would probably prefer to play over where Aaron Connolly is, where he can cut in like he does at club level onto his right foot, while our kind of natural thing with Robinson, at least under Mick McCarthy, was to play him on the right-hand side, where he much prefers to be on his right foot cutting in as opposed to going around defenders.
Yeah, but I think it actually worked quite well when we had Robinson and Coleman playing together, because Coleman overlapped quite well with Robinson. Robinson was able to get the ball and get it out to him quickly. And if the channel wasn't there for Coleman to run into, they were able to cut it back to Robinson and he was able to get crosses into the box. I thought it actually, that axis worked quite well. So if that's going to be the combination against Finland, then yes, Robinson might prefer over than the left hand side. But if he's not going to be playing there, he'd prefer to play as opposed to not to play.
Emmet, how do you see Ireland lining up? Are you thinking Stephen Kenny's going to be good to his word, like he was last night when he said maybe two or three changes max? He's probably going to go with roughly the same team, or what kind of lineup are you expecting to see on Sunday evening?
Yeah, I'd echo Enda's sentiments there. Really, I'd expect Malumbi to come in maybe for Hourihan, maybe Callum Robinson for O'Dowda, and possibly Seamus Coleman to come back in. But I think a fairly similar lineup. And I think for everything I've heard about Finland, I don't think that'd be a huge test for us. I think it's a pretty good opportunity to get for Kenny to get off his reign to a decent start.
And when it comes to this, Enda, look, the Nations League is important because these are going to have points that could be important for World Cup qualification, particularly if you don't do particularly well in your group. This is a fantastic backup option to try and qualify if you've done well in the Nations League. Mick McCarthy was saying in the commentary last night that he maybe misunderstood the competition when it started, but he thought it was great by the end of it. Do you think that Ireland can give this a good go in terms of the group? I'm guessing Wales are the strong favourites to win it, but can Ireland give them a run in this group?
Yeah, I mean, if you're looking at this group from the start, whether you favour Stephen Kenny or not, if you're not battling it out with Wales to win this group, then you're doing something wrong. So they absolutely should be. I do think Wales have too much quality in their side for us at the minute. The likes of Gareth Bale and Aaron Ramsey, and even if you go lower down their ranks, Ethan Ampadu is also an excellent footballer. So they probably have too much quality for Ireland at the minute, but who knows, if Stephen Kenny can get this team going now against Finland, then they have a great chance against Wales.
Yeah,
it's going to be tight. Well, Mick McCarthy again, it was one of those weird contradictory moments where earlier on in the game he said that, you know, maybe I didn't really understand the Nations League when it was happening and how important it was, and then by the end of the game he was talking about how good the Nations League was and how much of an important competition it is. I mean, I will note,
though, that he didn't talk about how important it was to the Tier 2 and Tier 3 teams, but he said it was great to see Holland against England and Portugal playing against Ukraine. So it was very much about the Pool A teams. Well, that's all to look forward to. Don't forget that we will have live coverage on Off the Ball, 5 p.m. kickoff this coming Sunday. Stewie Byrne will be in the commentary box at the empty Aviva Stadium alongside Nathan Murphy for full live commentary on Off the Ball. We're looking forward to that. If you're having a bet this weekend, the very best of luck. And we will speak to you next Friday.
The Paddy Power Half Hour on Off the Ball.
With Paddy Power, as obnoxiously passionate about soccer as Frank Lampard after the final whistle.
Gamble responsibly. CWE.net.